John Carmack, and for the unusual event, he's not going to be talking a bunch of tech here because he's going to have his whole presentation for us. So we're just going to get to know a little bit more about him. Hi, John.
Hi.
So I was wondering, these are some of the things I've always just wondered. Did you make good grades in school?
So I went to a private Catholic school for first through sixth grade, and I did think I got a good education there. And it was interesting because I've been kind of atheist since I learned how to think, but I still got along okay at the Catholic school. But I did fall off quite a bit when I transferred to a public school in seventh grade, and it was a little bit rocky there. My grades were kind of proportional to how much homework they expected from me.
Was it not challenging or what?
I wasn't really into the whole do the academics in school. I mean, I appreciated math and science and all that, and I got excellent test scores on everything, but just wasn't going to go home and do a lot of homework.
Right. No, that makes perfect sense, and I can see that. Who were your heroes growing up?
You know, in grade school, I was the person that when you're doing your class project or whatever, I picked Thomas Edison. So I'm like, okay, my hero is the inventor. It's not the sports hero or the Nobel Peace Prize.
That's cool.
It's the inventor. And I knew that from a really young age.
Yeah. Did you foresee, going back to soft disk and when all of this first started, did you foresee that you would be where you are now then?
So it's not possible to really think about the orders of magnitude of progress that we've seen since then. And no, I didn't envision myself being, I mean, it's hard to even think about kind of the success that I've gotten at that point. I knew what I wanted to be is I wanted to be somebody like Lord British, Richard Garriott. They were, you know, sort of my heroes as a teenager on there, where there was that time making the awesome games, clearly successful on here. And the funny thing was, I thought I had missed the boat. By the time I was a late teenager on there, I'm like, it's passing me by, the period to go and, you know, and make this impact in the industry, that the people that are the pioneers, that's over and I'm going to miss my opportunity. And it's funny how it worked out, because there was a book that I read several times called Hackers, Heroes of the Computer Revolution. It was a well-written book, but it talked about like the early MIT guys, the early hardware guys, like Jobs and Wozniak. And then the third part was on the game hackers. And it's like, oh, I should be in this book. This is really bothering me. But, you know, 5 or 10 years after that, I realized that, well, if they had had a fourth part, it would have been on the 3D gaming creators.
That's exactly right.
And I would have been in that part.
That's right. It wasn't even created yet.
And you know, I think that there's probably a lot of people that have similar feelings like that right now, where they're thinking, oh, I missed the best part. But I actually think the best part is right around the corner. I think that there are changes that are going to be happening that will let those people that, you know, that have an opportunity to make a huge mark like that.
Yeah, absolutely. It's amazing how it keeps on going. So I have a question for you. How has having children impacted you?
You know, it's a cliche, but it's true, in that you really can't imagine what having kids is going to be like for you. And, you know, I could look at things from an intellectual perspective, but it doesn't sink in until you've got your kids just looking up at daddy when he comes home. And I love my family so much.
That's so cool. That is awesome. Because I don't imagine, I think that maybe this was part of how come you went from Ferraris to Tesla and where you are now. Is that right?
No, it actually had nothing to do with that.
Really?
Having children on there. And the thing that started it down really was when we moved our office the previous time,
mm-hmm.
where it had been for a long time, we had a highway access road that led up to the office, which meant I sort of had my personal drag strip going to the office every morning. And, you know, I never bought the cars to be a flashy symbol of like what people look at. I mean, I don't care about that, but I enjoyed driving the cars there and being able to go to 140 miles an hour before the office every morning on there. That sort of justified the science project experimentalism of all of that. And after we moved, and I would find some days where I'm driving around these somewhat cantankerous, fussy cars in some ways, and realize that I hadn't floored it in a week on there. And I started realizing, you know, that's just really not, it's not the right car at this point.
Right.
And something like the Tesla turns out to be an interesting thing because it's electric on there. It has, you know, all the power instantly, where you standing start, floor it, and you've immediately got all the torque. And it's
cool.
It's not the Ferraris. I need to write all about all my car stories at some point because I have so many great things to say about them. But when you have a 1,000 horsepower car, it's it sets a lot of standards on there, but it's the type of thing you need to plan to use that. You need to make sure that there's like nobody in the upcoming half mile going on, and it makes a horrendous amount of noise. It's antisocial to actually use that. While the Tesla, it's just a big rubber band. Just every time you're at a stop sign, you can floor it and just kind of get pulled away. And it's something that if you're staying at anything resembling legal speeds, it's one of the most fun cars I've ever had. If you want to go 190 miles an hour, it's obviously not the right car for that, but it's also interesting to be sort of the test pilot for the future sort of thing with the high-performance electric cars. There's a number of interesting things there, but it's not so great for my 45-minute drive into the office right now.
Which is why you're going to move. Get a little bit closer. Yeah, actually, we were just at the Porsche dealership the other day, and one of the guys remembers you from having those, and because Porsches, you just end up tweaking and tweaking and tweaking. Mm-hmm. And Duncan told me the other day, said, I can't move any closer because I just get it up to where I want to go.
Other great thing about the electric cars is there's no warm-up period. You can feel you don't have to feel bad about yourself to ease out of the parking garage and floor it immediately. Which, if you've got an expensive piston engine, you just know that you're not. That's not good.
All right. I know you're really big on efficiency. Mm-hmm. What would you say is the biggest time waster in your day that you have to do? It's a necessary thing, but you would like to get rid of.
I mean, it's clearly sleeping as much as I have to. Where, you know, one of the things that's supposed to be common in like young gifted kids or whatever is that they don't need as much sleep. And I've always thought I got robbed on that because I can just feel my IQ dropping if I don't get 8 hours of sleep.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, I had a programmer, John Cash, working for me for a while, and he was hyperactive on 4 hours of sleep. He was just the kind of guy that could do that. I'm like, man, 4 extra hours a day, I'd pay millions of dollars to just have that extra slice of a day given to me.
Okay, so you were talking a little bit about how you come from being at Softest up to where you are now. What would you say, because for me it doesn't seem like you've had that many challenging plateaus. It's like just one great thing after another. Have there been any challenging spots for you?
There's challenges in every project. And as I look back at the most challenging was the original Quake, where we had had such a string of exponential successes going from Commander Keen's, and then the second one, then Wolfenstein, and then Doom, and each one was like this huge step over the other ones. And there was, you know, probably a little bit of a feeling of invincibility about just how fast and wonderful everything was going. And I laid out this large slate of features and things that I was going to be doing in there. And I sat down, I worked harder than I'd ever worked on it, and it was just the focus of everything. And it still wasn't coming together nearly as fast as we wanted it to. And I was just, you know, struggling. I was doing my absolute best, and it still wasn't quite good enough to get things done on there. And I did have visions at the time, kind of the old story of John Henry, just like, you know, beating on the railroad till his heart exploded on there. And that was kind of coming to grips with the fundamental limits of your ability. And no matter how good you are and how talented, there are limits to what you can accomplish, and you have to take that into account as you start planning things in the future. So, you know, we were really late on that. It came out, and it was, in many ways, seminal and great. I mean, my wife still thinks it's the greatest thing that we ever did, but I do look back at that as so many things that we didn't get into there or that we wanted to, and
right. It
had fallen short of what the initial goal was, as well as taking a lot longer. And that was certainly good for me. It was humbling in one way to not just think that I'm a superhero and I can do anything if I just put my mind to it and work hard for 2 more weeks without sleep or something. But, you know, that's made me a much more mature developer for everything after that. And not that we actually get things done when we expect them to now, but I certainly came out the better for it on that. And we have had projects that weren't successful, like our foray into the Nintendo DS, moving a cell phone title over. That wasn't successful, but it's been good that all of our big projects have been successes. And even when we had something that maybe wasn't as spectacular of a success as the previous one, they've all been great. And
right.
You know, I'm fortunate in there's certainly planning and talent and all this is a factor in there. But, you know, luck and good fortune is there. I mean, I'm not going to say that I'm in my position strictly because I'm that much better than everybody else who's not in the position. We have had good fortune on a number of occasions. But on the other hand, good fortune is a matter of doing 1,000 things well and just making sure that you don't skimp on the work that you need to do and you keep paying attention and focusing on what really matters rather than just kind of meandering off into something that feels a little pleasant at the time.
Right. Well, I've been a big fan forever. Actually since Wolfenstein. But I'm really privileged that you came and talked to us, and I thank you so much. I look forward to hearing you speak.
All right, great. Thank you
so much. Mm-hmm.